hiker's worst nightmare. As the sun began to set, a group of friends set out on a hike through the remote wilderness. They were experienced hikers and had all the necessary gear. But as they made their way deeper into the forest, they began to feel like they were being watched. As the darkness settled in, they found a clearing and set up camp. The night was quiet, except for the occasional rustling in the bushes. The group huddled together, sharing ghost stories and trying to shake off the eerie feeling that had settled over them. Just as they were about to settle in for the night, they heard a blood-curdling scream coming from the woods. They hesitated for a moment, but then, being the brave group they were, decided to investigate. They followed the sound, flashlight beams cutting through the darkness. Suddenly, they stumbled upon an old abandoned cabin. It was run down and decrepit, the windows boarded up and the door hanging off its hinges. Despite their initial reluctance, the group pushed open the door and stepped inside. It was dark and musty, and they could barely see anything. They fumbled for their flashlights, casting beams of light around the room. That's when they saw it, a figure huddled in the corner. It was a young girl, shivering and scared. She was covered in dirt, and her clothes were torn. The group rushed over to help her, but as they got closer, they realized there was something horribly wrong. The girl's eyes were pitch black, and her skin was cold to the touch. Suddenly, she let out a blood-curdling scream, and the group realized too late that they had stumbled into a trap. The girl was a lure, a trick to lure unsuspecting hikers to the cabin. The group was attacked from all sides by a group of feral cannibals, and despite their best efforts, they were no match for the savage horde. Their screams echoed through the cabin as they were torn apart by the bloodthirsty cannibals. The night air was filled with the stench of death, and as the sun rose the next morning, there was no trace of the group of friends. The Manor by the Lake. It's the year 1723. A young village girl named Sarah is walking through the fields on her way home to help her mother for supper. Sarah comes from a common household of hard-working farmers. They are not rich, and they are not of nobility. They live in a quiet little village nestled along a lake, in the shadow of the river's manor, the ruling class of the valley. As Sarah walks through the door, she greets her mother. "Where have you been?" her mother asked. "Just walking through the fields and reading my book," Sarah replied. "This letter came for you this morning," her mother said. When Sarah opened it, a wide smile came across her face. "I got it," she exclaimed. "I got it."
"Got what?"
her mother asked. "This is a letter from the river's manor. There was an opening for a servant girl, and I've been accepted," Sarah gleefully replied.
"No, no," said her mother. "I will not allow it. There's a reason there's an opening at the manor. There's always eventually an opening up there. Sarah, do you know how many young girls have went to work there and then just disappear?" Her mother asked her.
"Oh, mother, that's nonsense. You're acting like there's something nefarious going on up there. I'm sure there's a reasonable explanation for that. People move on, you know," said Sarah. "There's nothing you can say, mother, to change my mind. I know you and father are having troubles with the farm. We need the money. I start tomorrow."
Despite her parents' objections, Sarah started out early the next morning towards the manor. When she arrived, she introduced herself to the head butler, Reginald.
"Hello, sir.
My name is Sarah.
Ah, yes, the new servant girl, Reginald replied. You are just in time, my dear. We're completely swamped. We're in a rush, trying to get ready for the party tonight, and we're already missing two girls.
Where do you need me, sir?
Sarah was eager to get started. I will put you on decorations, then you can help in the kitchen, replied Reginald. Sarah went about her tasks, making the manor look festive for tonight's party. Lord Rivers always threw the most lavish parties in the land, and tonight would be no exception. Sarah then went to the kitchen and helped with the hors d'oeuvres. But then, it was time to prepare the main course. She and the other servants were ushered out and given another task to complete.
What was that? Sarah asked another servant girl named Julie,
who she had become quick friends with. Lord River's mother and his sisters always prepare the main course. It's always quite secretive. For some reason, the servants are never allowed in the kitchen when they are preparing the main course, whispered Julie. Just then, Reginald appeared from around the corner. Back to work, ladies. No time for talking.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
As the two ladies walked away, Sarah noticed a strange look on Reginald's face, but didn't think much about it and went back to work. It was now 8 in the evening. The manor was decorated, the food was prepared, and the guests started to arrive. Sarah spent the party serving hors d'oeuvres. Then, when it was time for the main course, she served wine at the table. The party went off without a hitch, as the village's wealthiest families wined and dined. Then, at the stroke of midnight, the party came to a close. The servants cleaned up and headed back home to the village. Sarah and Julie hugged and said their goodbyes and told each other that they would see them at work the next morning. Sarah walked in and saw her mother still up waiting for her by the fireside.
What are you still doing up? Asked Sarah.
Waiting for you to get home from that evil place. Sarah laughed.
What are you talking about? The manor was beautiful. Everyone was nice and pleasant to work with. I even made a friend, a nice girl named Julie. And as you can see, I made it back in one piece.
Don't get smart with me, girl, exclaimed her mother. You're not too old to feel the back of my hand, child.
I'm sorry, Mother. I'm tired and I'm going to bed. I have to get to work early, again in the morning.
Sarah continued to work at the manor with no problems for a month, becoming best friends with Julie and enjoying each day she worked up at the manor, the parties she looked forward to each week, and the money she brought home to her family gave Sarah great pride. Sarah saw no problems at the manor, even brushing off her mother's worries when another servant girl disappeared. Sarah always told her mother the same thing.
Reginald told me she moved away. Or Reginald told me she fell in love and quit. Or Reginald told me this and that, etc., etc.
Sarah was excited to get to work this day. It was the night of the weekly party, and it was her 1 month anniversary of working at the manor. When she arrived, she got her assignment from Reginald and began her tasks. She was about an hour in and noticed Julie wasn't there. That's strange, Sarah thought. She hasn't missed a day's work since I've been working at the manor. Sarah went to Reginald and asked where Julie was. He looked at her with a smug sneer and said,
I don't know.
She never arrived this morning, and it's no concern of yours. Get back to work, girl.
Yes, sir, Sarah replied, and went back about her chores,
all the while thinking, this isn't like Julie. She never missed work, and I just talked to her last night. She was fine, and she said she would see me in the morning. She was just as excited about tonight's party as I was.
This just doesn't make sense. She approached Reginald and asked again, where was Julie? She could see he was getting flustered. At this point, listen, if you know what's good for you, you'll shut your mouth and get back to your business, girl. Reginald barked at her. Sarah was shocked. No one has ever talked to her in that manner before. But as she got to the kitchen, she replayed his words and thought about all the missing girls from the manor and thought maybe something nefarious had happened to Julie. She went about chopping vegetables and tried to act as if everything was fine. But as she looked up, she saw through the window Lord Rivers and his assistants carrying something out of the cellar. It didn't look like an ordinary large cut of beef. It was covered, and it had the shape of a body. Just then, Reginald walked in and said, "Time to leave, everyone. It's time to prepare the main course." He walked and turned out, leading the other servants. Sarah started towards the door behind everyone, but at the last moment broke off and hid in the pantry. What is such the big secret? She thought. I have to find out. She waited for a few moments. Then the back door opened. The men plopped the hunk of beef on the table and walked out. Sarah opened the pantry door and slowly walked towards the shrouded hunk of beef. The smell was putrid. It smelled like it had been baking out in the sun. She turned back the shroud and felt her heart sink. It was Julie. My God, Sarah thought. She was in complete shock. Her body gripped in fear. Just then a woman's voice behind her said, I see you discovered our secret, dear. Welcome to the menu. Just then she felt a thud on the back of her head, and the room went dark. It was another successful Rivers party at the manor. The wealthy wined and dined, as usual. Before the meal ended, Lord Rivers' mother stood up and gave a toast to Julie and Sarah, the founders of the feast. I love those little rustic inns. Have you ever stayed in one of those little rustic inns? You know the kind I'm talking about, right? The ones that are out in the middle of nowhere, have no guests, and are invariably owned by an elderly couple. Probably not. They seem to be dying off faster than their owners. It's sad, but understandable. Whenever you go, people want to stay in comfortable hotels next to all the big tourist attractions. No one wants to rough it in a converted farmhouse miles from civilization. It really is a shame, though. I go out of my way to stay at them, and I've never had a bad experience. The service is always good. The owners make excellent meals, and I find something about the solitude of these places comforting. I seem to be in the minority, though. Whenever I tell other people about them, they're surprised I feel safe there. They seem to think it's impossible to stay in a place like that without getting murdered in your sleep or eaten by a cannibalistic innkeeper. I just laugh at them. They've watched too many horror movies. After all, I've stayed in hundreds of these little places and walked away unharmed every single time. Of course, I can't say the same thing about the owners. Cantu Porto, Captain's Log, Journal Entry 1. Cargo and scientific supplies securely stored away in the cargo hold of the Neptune's Library, a scientific and research vessel, which happens to be the very finest in the Queen's Navy. We left port around 9:30 in the a.m., August 13th, year of our Lord, 1888. We set sail on a scientific expedition bound for the Isle of Cantu Porto, a small island off the coast of Costa Rica. From my understanding, when we arrive, we will be the first foreigners to step foot on the island. Having never been explored, I am very excited, but at the same time, not being ashamed to admit, very nervous. This is my first captaincy, and I feel obligated to perform to the best of my abilities and prove my superiors correct in putting their faith in me and trust for such an important expedition. I am tasked with leading a seaworthy crew of 120, plus a group of four of the country's leading scientists, and a detachment of Marines to explore the mysterious island of Cantu Porto. The crew looks able of their tasks and willing to do them. Those are my first impressions anyway. The officers under me, for the most part, seem capable and knowledgeable of their duties, with the exception of two young lieutenants who were forced upon me through nepotistic connections. It's not ideal, but it's nothing I can't handle. The first day has been a success, and as I head for bed, I am filled with hope and excitement for what this expedition will bring. Here's hoping for success. Ezekiel Hampton, Captain of Neptune's Library, signing out. Captain's Log, Journal, Entry 2, August 15th. Nothing of note since my last entry 2 days ago. The men's spirits are high, and the camaraderie is growing between the crew. A few disciplinary incidents cropped up, but nothing serious. We are on schedule, and the expedition is going according to plan. Side note, one of the young lieutenants, a Mr. Theodore Ransford, might need some looking out for. He seems a superstitious and incapable fellow, two things that could bring disaster to a voyage and crew. I'll put one of the senior officers in charge of the situation. Captain's Log, Journal, Entry 3, August 17th. Nothing of note happened yesterday, but today the young Lieutenant Ransford was caught spreading rumors amongst the men that this expedition was cursed. I don't think it worked. We're too early into the voyage, and there's been no signs of this expedition being cursed. I'll have the officers keep an eye on the men in the meantime, but everything seems fine. Mr. Ransford has been relieved of his duties and confined to his quarters until we return to port. Captain's Log, Journal, Entry 4, August 18th. Sat down with the lead scientist of the expedition, a Professor Reginald Bartholomew, a truly brilliant man, the top researcher in the entire country, and after a brief conversation with him, I can see why. I sat down with him because I wanted to specifically find out what exactly it was we were to research on the island. He responded, "Everything." The entire documentation of the island was to be recorded, plants, rocks, sand, soil, trees, and any living organisms that we come across was to be sampled. Then after the scientific findings were collected, we are to leave a small base camp with two of the scientists, a handful of Marines, and a year's worth of supplies to plant our country's flag and take control of the island until we return with more men and supplies. Professor Bartholomew then proceeded to tell me if we find the things he thinks we'll find on the island, then we'll return home as heroes and become famous men for the things we discover. I quickly pointed out, "That's all well and good, but I'm not in it for fame. I serve only Queen and country. That's where my loyalty ends." I wished the professor a pleasant evening and went to bed. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 5. August 20th. A panic amongst the crew has broken out. Bosun's mate Devers was found hanging from the crow's nest with a sign hanging around his neck that read, "Return home. The ship and voyage is cursed. Turn around now before it is too late." An investigation has taken place for this ghastly crime. I put the sergeant of arms, a grizzled veteran by the name of William Smythe, in charge, though I have my suspicions of who carried out this egregious act. My suspicions were proven correct when I sent the sergeant of arms and two other officers down to check on the young disgraced Lieutenant Ransford in his quarters, but when they called on him, he was not there. The lock was broken and the door was left ajar. There's no sign of the young Mr. Ransford, but we must find him before he sets the crew off into hysterics. Wish us luck, for I fear the future of our voyage depends on finding him. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 6, August 21st. Sadly, I must report another death. The sergeant-at-arms was found dead in his bed, his throat slit from ear to ear, with a message above his head written in blood to beware. Return at all costs. The officers are reporting whispers from the men in their sections that the ship is cursed. This must be stopped quickly before the ship is thrown into chaos. There's only so many places Ransford could be hiding. He must be found and quartered before it's too late. We'll keep up to date of the situation as it unfolds. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 7, August 23rd. The past 2 days, me and my officers partook in a painstakingly desperate search for the mad, disgraced Lieutenant Ransford. But I am happy to report he was found by a young Master Jacobs, a fine lad. Reminder to put in recommendations for a promotion. The crazed Ransford was found in a corner of the bowels of the ship, feasting on rat carcasses, and surrounded by pieces of flesh of his victims. Was he also feasting on his victims as well? I shudder to think of such depravity. His body is also completely covered in carvings of his flesh that read, "Cursed, doomed, turn back," and "Warning." Truly a disturbed individual. Does he suffer from scurvy, or was he simply mad before stepping foot on this vessel? Whatever the case, he will face trial tomorrow, out on the upper deck for his crimes. He will be made an example of. We can't afford any more setbacks on this important expedition. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 8, August 24th. The trial of Lieutenant Theodore Ransford commenced, and he was sentenced to death for his crimes by his peers, and I carried out the sentence. He was hanged from the main mast of the ship, 9 o'clock, the morning of August 24th, in the year of our Lord, 1888. I pray, after this, we can put this craziness behind us and get back on schedule. I just hope the crew has not been lost. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 9, September 18th. Apologies for not keeping a consistent update to the journal, but it has been quite the task to keep the crew together. Last night a mutiny of sorts was squashed by my master of the boat, Jedediah Hollingsworth. He and a few of the Marines were making their nightly patrols and came across a small group of crazed men trying to overtake the ship. These turncoats were foaming at the mouth, talking of a curse. Disciples of the mad Ransford, no doubt. They were quickly gagged and will be put on trial later on today. It will be swift. Their fates are sealed. Mutineers hang in the Queen's Navy. On a personal note, It's my birthday today. Waking up and hearing of a mutiny wasn't the greatest of gifts. So many setbacks have befell this expedition. Will I live to see another birthday? I hope so. I'll try and keep a more consistent entry to my journals. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 10, October 13th. It has been over a month since my last entry. I would apologize, but there have been reasons for my absence. Keeping the crew together has been a difficult task. Multiple mutinies have transpired since my last entry, from more of the cursed believers to a band of men who were ex-privateers, not content because there was no loot to be had at the end of this voyage. And that's what happens when you fill the ranks of your navy with ex-pirates. Reminder to formally complain to my superiors when we return to port. I know my journal entry of this voyage has not been consistently updated, but Professor Bartholomew has been keeping an updated one of his own, so no fear. Hopefully, there are no more setbacks. I believe if everything goes smoothly from here on out, we will reach the Isle of Cantu Porto within a month. Tomorrow is All Hallows' Eve. Wish us luck on the night where the dead supposedly return to the living. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 11, November 21st, Joyous News. I was awoken at dawn from shouts on deck of land. I jumped out of bed and ran out on deck. I could hear shouts from the crow's nest of land ho! I retrieved my binoculars from the casing and spotted the white sandy beaches of Cantu Porto. Finally, I exclaimed to myself, sighing a deep breath of relief. We finally made it. It was a grueling journey, but we finally made it. Updated numbers, 100 crew members, 4 scientists, and a detachment of 50 naval marines. Supplies are still well stocked, and the remaining men's spirits have been lifted from seeing the island. Myself and my fellow officers are to meet with Professor Bartholomew and his team of scientists and put together an expedition party to search the island in the morning. Things are finally starting to look up. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 12, November 22nd. History was made this morning. As we came to shore and stepped foot on land, we became the first foreigners to arrive on the island in its history. I personally planted our country's flag, declaring it part of the empire. What a moment. We then set up a base camp a few feet inland from the beach, then accompanied the science team on their search for new specimens. I'd say the first day was a success. Countless new species of plants and minerals were discovered, not to mention many exotic animals that the civilized world had never encountered before was found. Professor Bartholomew was very pleased with the findings, so I'm very pleased as well. Mark the first day off as a success. This expedition may go flawlessly, after all. Captain's Log, Journal Entry 13, November 23rd. An interesting turn of events transpired today while the second day of our scientific documentation was taking place. One of the scientists, a man by the name of Timothy Scott, and his marine escort came across a native. It was shocking at first, because we didn't come across any signs of human life the previous day. The native was skittish at first, but after a while, a form of communication was developed, and he took us back to his tribe. When we arrived, we met the tribal elders and chief. The people seemed warm and friendly, somewhat intelligent. But what can you expect from people without the teachings of a modernized world? Communication has been difficult, but Professor Bartholomew and his team have figured out a way they believe is working to communicate. Let's hope they are correct. Before leaving, we decided to leave Professor Bartholomew and his team, along with a few Marines, to stay at the village to develop a rapport with the villagers. The villagers seemed eager and willing at the idea as well. I'm sure they're just as interested in us as we are of them. I told Professor Bartholomew to find out as much as he could about the tribe and try to get the confidence of the chief. These are exciting times we find ourselves in. I can't wait until tomorrow. Captain's Log, Journal, Entry 14, November 25th. All hope is lost. This will be my last entry into this journal. As dawn approached, myself and a contingent of men embarked back to the village, filled with eagerness to hear of the goings-on in the village from Professor Bartholomew and his team, hoping for continued success in the relationship of our peoples. As the sun rose and we entered the village, we were greeted warmly by the chief and the villagers, but I did not see the research team, no sign of Professor Bartholomew or his men. I communicated to the chief, trying to find the whereabouts of the team. He began to laugh, then, in a broken form of English, said, "Bartholomew," and motioned to me to step forward. I walked a few paces forward to a simmering cauldron. A couple of older tribeswomen were stirring what looked like boiling meat and some kind of fruits or vegetables. After a few stirs, a head turned over, and as it did, the chief once again said, "Bartholomew," then laughed, and I pointed. It was a professor. His hair and most of his flesh were boiled off. I stood in complete shock. None of my men could see what was transpiring over my shoulder. I tried to give the orders to arms, but the words wouldn't come out. By the time I shook the fear and gave the order to attack, my men were surrounded and engulfed. I managed to run through the chief with my saber and run back towards the base camp on shore. The tribe was obviously working on a plan of attack throughout the night, because as I approached base camp, shouting to prepare for attack, I saw in horror my men being overrun and massacred by a contingent of tribal warriors. I barely escaped with my life and made it to the lifeboat. I rowed back to the ship and alerted the remaining men on board. To my surprise, a group of men just stood in place and gave up, awaiting their carnivorous fate, while others shouted, "Cursed," and jumped off the side of the ship and fled. There I stood, with 50 of Her Majesty's finest men ready to fight for our very existence. In the distance, we could see large bonfires being lit on the beach, the cries of our fellow men ringing out as they were being cooked alive. Frightening echoes in the tropical air as we readied for the boarding party of cannibalistic tribal warriors. We mowed down wave after wave of the cannibal tribesmen as they scaled over the railing, but in the end, we were outnumbered. Myself and three Marines were all that were left. When the last of the Marines fell, I managed to slice my way through a few of the warriors and barricade myself in my captain's quarters. I can hear my men outside the doors being eaten alive. Their cries of agony are hard to listen to. I just remembered what day it is. November the 25th. Now, we don't celebrate the day, but I know our allies in the colony celebrate a holiday called Thanksgiving. The irony and humor did not escape me, even in this moment. There's not much time left. It won't be long now. They're breaking down the doors to my cabin as I write this. To my family, I love you more than words can express. I hope this letter finds you well. Please remember me in happier times. To my superiors, I tried my best. They're almost in now. As the saying goes, a good captain always goes down with the ship.
Winter's coming. A moonless night made maneuvering the gravel road more challenging than he'd remembered. Jack had been driving for 3 hours, heading north to the family cabin near the Minnesota boundary waters. Only there was no family this time. Not this trip. In the span of 2 weeks, he'd been fired, gotten his second DUI, and was being blackmailed by his mistress. He needed some serious alone time. The cabin suddenly loomed up in the white car lights. It was as dark and lifeless as he was feeling. We make a perfect couple. Inside, he snapped on lights and then poured a half glass of scotch. It's only me, the mosquitoes, and Johnny Walker, he thought, lowering his body into a living room chair. His eyelids fell shut. Only moments later, there was a knock on the cabin door. "Who is it?" he called out. A raspy older man's voice responded.
"Hope we're not disturbing you. We're the O'Malleys from down the road. Saw your lights on and brought a pie."
They brought a pie? Great. I can't just tell them to fuck off. Getting a grasp on his emotions, Jack opened the door. The smiling couple standing under the porch light looked like everybody's grandma and grandpa, wrinkled, rosy, and wearing stretchy pastel clothes. The woman held out the pie with her gnarly, arthritic hands.
"It's mincemeat," she said in a high, wispy voice.
"I'm Henry," said the man, "and this is Ava."
Jack took the dessert. "Thank you so much. That's very kind of you. I was just..." Henry and Ava stood expectantly. "Oh, please come in."
"Thank you," responded Henry. "We'll only stay a minute."
Jack quickly made a pot of coffee, cut up and served the pie. "It's funny," he said. "My family and I have been coming up here for years, and we've never met before."
"That's because we don't spend much time around here in the summer,"
noted Henry.
"We have a motor home."
"We just got back from Montana," chirped Ava.
"Time to prepare for winter," added Henry. "It's long and cold up here. Where's the family?"
"Back in Minneapolis. Just need a little time to myself."
"Too bad."
"What?" Jack blinked. The room was turning fuzzy. "How much scotch did I drink?" he wondered. "Did you like the pie?" asked Ava. "It's an old family recipe." Jack was about to answer, but his tongue had gone numb. Ava smiled at him, but the warm grandmotherly expression had turned to a sardonic grin. He dropped his plate and squinted through a swirling haze as Henry picked up the knife used to cut the pie and licked the blade. "Why?" Jack managed to whisper.
"I told you," Henry hissed. "Winter's coming. It's time to stock the larder."
Huh.
hunting season. My new running route seemed unusually quiet for a Saturday afternoon. In fact, I hadn't passed or been passed by a soul. It was a cool, gusty fall day, and dry leaves crunched underfoot as I entered a shady, wooded stretch of the path. It was hunting season, so I wore a fluorescent orange cap, and although I felt self-conscious, it was better than being mistaken for prey. Between my clopping feet and heavy breathing, I thought I heard something out of context in the quiet woods, so I stopped for a moment to listen. At first, all I could make out was a distant tapping of a woodpecker and the rustling of leaves. Then, like a whisper, I heard a child crying. The sound was coming from my right, from somewhere in the shadows, but it couldn't be too far away. Was it a lost child? I followed the sobbing voice into the hazy grayness of the forest, stopping every few yards to listen. The crying grew louder as I picked my way through branches and brush, and soon I broke out into a large meadow of tall grass and froze. In the middle of the meadow was a deer stand with a speaker attached to it. This was the source of the child's cries. Then I saw a man, dressed in camouflage, looking in my direction. He slowly raised a rifle to his shoulder.
I would like to give a heartfelt thank you to the special friends of the channel. Your generosity means the world to me. If you would like to support the channel, the link is below in the description. Also, please send me your stories to duchessofdarkness27@gmail.com. You can also find me on Instagram at duchess.ofdarkness or Twitter at duchessofdarkn2. I want to thank you all for your support, your kindness, and your encouragement. I appreciate it so very much. Until next time.